Hello, you've reached SJ Thomason of ChristianApologist.com. That's Christian-Apologist.com. Today, I'm asking the question, is atheism a religion?
Hello, SJ Thomason. I am a Diana Athena Clarion, also known as the Lavender Lady. Today, I am responding to your question, is atheism a religion? Short answer is no. But you surely didn't make this 4-minute video just to hear that, so let's continue.
This question seems to be of interest to atheists, as evidenced in an unscientific Twitter poll I recently ran that generated around 10,000 impressions and 1,500 engagements. 79% of respondents indicated that atheism is not a religion. 10% indicated that atheism is a religion. 5% indicated that they did not know or care whether atheism is a religion. And 6% indicated that the poll made them mad. The comments that filled my notifications about the poll highlighted the importance of identifying the correct definition of religion. Accordingly, I will take a look at several definitions of religion to determine whether atheism should be considered a religion. I will further present reasons why atheists should want to be considered a religion.
I'd say that atheists are interested in this question only because religious adherents are interested in it and won't leave us alone about it. Otherwise, we are as physicist Steven Weinberg has described us, not caring enough about God to even know whether we are atheists. It surprises me that 6% of your respondents were angered by the poll only because I thought that figure would be much higher, given that theists, especially those of the fundamentalist stripe, are constantly badgering us with their dogged insistence that atheism be considered a religion. As to a correct definition of religion, as Dr. Michael W. Jones has often said, words have usage, not inherent meaning. Definitions are appropriate within contexts, rather than correct in a global sense, as we shall soon see.
Merriam-Webster defines religion in 4 ways. 1, the state of a religious, the service and worship of God or the supernatural, the commitment or devotion to religious faith or observance. 2, a personal set or institutionalized system of religious beliefs and practices. 3, scrupulous conformity. And 4, a cause, principle, or system of beliefs held to with ardor and faith.
Here's the definition set that SJ cited. Honestly, it made more sense to me in written rather than spoken form, but I suppose that is the way my mind works. So be it. Properly called lexical definitions, they list usages of the word in question from most to least popular. Now, as it turns out, the colloquial definition, that is, the one most often used in everyday parlance, is closest to Merriam-Webster's 1B, to wit, the service and worship of God or the supernatural, or the commitment or devotion to religious faith or observance. So, why did I go on about lexical and colloquial definitions? The reason is that not only do words have more than one definition, definitions themselves come in different flavors. We've seen 2 so far. A third type of definition is a scholarly definition, one used by those who study a field in depth. In the field of religious studies, scholars are unable to agree upon a definition of religion. In fact, Daniel Dubuisson doubts that the term religion has any meaning outside of Western culture, while Ernst, Feil doubts that it has any specific universal meaning at all.
The United States Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, the EEOC, defines religion broadly, and you can compare this definition with Merriam-Webster's 4th definition, as the ultimate ideas about life, purpose, and death.
And here we have a 4th type of definition, a legal definition, which is used to specify the scope of a term within legislation or regulation. For the full context of Thomason's citation, we can turn to Section 12 of the EEOC's Compliance Manual relating to religious discrimination, and I quote, "Religious beliefs include theistic beliefs as well as non-theistic moral or ethical beliefs as to what is right and wrong, which are sincerely held with the strength of traditional religious values. Although courts generally resolve doubts about particular beliefs in favor of finding that they are religious, beliefs are not protected merely because they are strongly held. Rather, religion typically concerns ultimate ideas about life, purpose, and death, social, political, or economic philosophies, as well as mere personal preferences, are not religious beliefs protected by Title VII." End quote. Again, what is the reason I am going on about these definitions of definitions? Well, here it comes.
Atheists, excluding those in Buddhist or Jain sects, or sects with similar beliefs, place a premium on this life and do not believe in the next or a higher godly purpose. So they live their lives accordingly. Their beliefs about life, purpose, and death therefore differ from theist beliefs. Because of the EEOC's broad definition, the EEOC includes atheism among the protected religious groups under Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. This act prohibits discrimination in employment against workers or job seekers due to their sincerely held beliefs. Employers cannot make employment decisions that adversely impact people due to their religious beliefs unless the religious beliefs are considered bona fide occupational qualifications. For example, a Baptist church may require a Baptist pastor as a bona fide occupational qualification. Accordingly, it is to atheist benefits to be defined broadly as a religion.
Thomason is using the EEOC's legal definition of religion to broadly define the term. But to what purpose?
Religion. So why do atheists resist being defined as a religion? Firstly, they may resist due to their conception that religion follows Merriam-Webster's first definition and includes the worship of God or the supernatural. Secondly, they may resist because if atheism is defined as a religion or system of beliefs instead of a lack of belief in God, they can't claim that theists have the burden of proof to provide evidence for the belief in God. In my opinion, it is the second reason that drives many atheists to reject the assertion that atheism is a religion, even though they may reap legal protections, tax benefits, and stronger rights when defined as a religion. In other words, I would advise my atheist friends to consider themselves part of a religion.
Here, it becomes necessary to define another term, equivocation, from the Department of Philosophy of Texas State University. The fallacy of equivocation occurs when a key term or phrase in an argument is used in an ambiguous way, with one meaning in one portion of the argument and then another meaning in another portion of the argument. The funny thing about a legal definition is that it need not bear any relation to any practical use of the term. A simultaneously hilarious and sad example of this is described in a New York Times article of 11 October 2013, the first line of which reads, "Donald E. Miller Jr. is legally dead," an Ohio judge explained to Donald E. Miller Jr. this week in court. That same judge, Alan H. Davis of Hancock County Probate Court, had declared Mr. Miller dead in 1994, several years after he had mysteriously disappeared, leaving thousands of dollars of child support unpaid. His ex-wife, Robin Miller, had requested the declaration at the time so that she could apply for Social Security benefits for their two daughters. In court that day, a man who was quite obviously alive was told that he was dead for the purposes of Ohio law. To begin her argument, Thomason defines religion lexically, but switches to a legal definition in reference to atheism. By her own admission, Thomason employs this shell game in an attempt to drop into our laps a burden of proof that we do not properly shoulder. In this, she is equivocating, rendering her argument invalid. Now, the funny thing about equivocation is that while it can be accidental, it more often is not. As always, references are in the description. For Vox Rationis, I am Diana Clarion, and I thank you for watching.